Tentor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Blown to Hell, America's Deadly Betrayal of the Marshall Islanders, by Walter Pincus. Narrated by Chris Abernathy. Prologue. Before dawn, on March 1, 1954, John Anjain got up from his palm mat bed and walked out of the plywood, thatched-roof house he shared with his wife and their five children on the Pacific Ocean atoll of Rongelap. At a clearing nearby, he began to lay out rows of coconut pieces. After a day baking in the sun, these pieces would become copra, Rongelap's chief cash crop. Anjain, 32, was a quiet, unassuming man, well-liked and respected as magistrate of the atoll. He was slight of stature, brown-skinned, square-faced, with his black hair already touched with gray, pushed back in a slight pompadour. Only a few could have known that this innocent, humble father and his family, including his then 1-year-old son Legich, would have their simple lives imperiled by deadly radioactive fallout from a hydrogen bomb test that morning some 120 miles away, detonated by American scientists and military personnel. Rongelap is one of the 29 atolls and 5 islands that make up the Marshall Islands, which lie 2,100 miles southwest of Hawaii and 2,400 miles east of Japan. An atoll is a circular coral reef surrounding a lagoon. The Rongelap Atoll has 61 tiny islets forming a more square than circular chain around a 388-square-mile pristine blue-green lagoon. A smaller atoll, named Islingani, 8 miles to the west, was generally uninhabited, but the Rongelap people often went there to gather crabs, fish, and turtle eggs. The islands were originally settled 2,000 to 3,000 years ago by people who sailed east from Southeast Asia. They first landed in Yap, an island west of the Philippines. Then some moved south to New Guinea, others east to the Solomon Islands, and finally northeast to the Marshalls. After Spanish explorers in the 16th century visited Rongelap and nearby atolls, only whalers and traders passed through that part of the Pacific until missionaries arrived in the 19th century. Local chieftains controlled the atolls, with the current Kabua family line owning Rongelap going back to the 1860s. In 1885, Germany purchased the Marshall Islands from Spain and established a trading outpost, mainly for copra. Japan, allied with Great Britain in World War I, won the Marshalls as its price for entering the fight. In the years that followed, Japanese companies developed the copra trade, while Japan's military developed Kwajalein Atoll as a military base. In January 1944, after months of fighting, American World War II forces took control of the Marshalls. When the war ended, the U.S. maintained governance under the auspices of the United Nations as part of the Trust Territory of the Pacific Islands, with an American High Commissioner serving from within the Interior Department's Office of Insular Affairs. The first American tests of atomic weapons in the Marshall Islands, Operation Crossroads, began in 1946 in Bikini Atoll, 125 miles west of Rongelap. Tests then transferred to the U.S. mainland at the Nevada test site before being moved back to the Marshalls because the new generation of thermonuclear bombs being developed had yields so large that officials feared radioactive fallout could not be safely contained at any site in the United States. On March 1, 1954, 82 men, women, and children were living on Rongelap Island, the largest island in that atoll, although only a half mile wide and 6 miles long. That March 1st morning, 18 of these Rongelapis were at neighboring Islingani Atoll gathering food. Their houses were made mostly of palm leaves with coral pebble floors, but a few, such as John Anjain's, were built partly of wood. Some houses had connecting sheds where cooking was done. Windows and doors were covered with burlap or canvas. The men of the atoll fished the Rongelap Lagoon in wooden outriggers or along the coral reef several days a week, catching sturgeon and parrotfish. Now and then they dug arrowroot, a plant with tuberous roots that cook into a dish resembling tapioca. Whenever they could, they collected fresh coconuts. On Rongelap, on nearby islands around the lagoon, and on the islands of Islingani Atoll, coconut meat made up a major part of the Rongelapese diet, and dried it became copra, the atoll's major export. Coconut milk supplemented the rainwater they collected and stored in 8 communal cisterns built by the Japanese during their occupation. The women spent their days gathering food, cooking, and caring for children. They also looked after the cultivation of taro. In a tropical climate, taro plants grow from 3 to 5 feet high, with starchy stems that are like macaroni when cooked. The peeled roots, when blanched and sun-dried for a day, can be milled into flour for bread and donuts. Another important food was pandanus, a stringy fruit the size of a pineapple, which grows on tuberous trees found all over the Marshall Islands. Pandanus fruit has a sweet juice or thick nectar that tastes like a mix of sugarcane and mango. Also on Rongelap Island were 150 chickens, pecking out their food from tossed-aside pieces of coconut. Their eggs, eaten raw, were considered a delicacy. There were also cats and ducks and 10 swine. On special occasions, a whole pig was cooked for an island feast. Once every 3 or 4 months, a trading ship run by the U.S. Trust Territory government arrived to buy copra, in return for which the Rongelapis bought rice, flour, and such luxuries as canned meats, lemonade powder, and jelly. The children gave the ship's crew and passengers, mostly Marshallese traveling to or from their home atolls, little shells in exchange for gum and candy. The women also sold bags and mats woven from coconut or pandanus leaves, and used the money earned to buy plastic combs and cheap Japanese cloth for dresses. The men traded enormous clam and conch shells from the lagoon for liquor and cigarettes. While a ship was anchored in the lagoon, all work stopped. But within days of its departure, the new goods were gone, the excitement was forgotten, and the Rongelapis returned to their simple daily struggle to gather food. 8 years earlier, in May 1946, the Americans had temporarily moved the inhabitants of Rongelap to Lai, an island almost 300 miles away from Bikini Lagoon. The very first atomic tests at Bikini Atoll were to take place that July. The evacuation was a precaution the Americans followed for all Marshallese living within 300 miles of Bikini. When Operation Crossroads was concluded in August and the danger of radiation fallout had passed, the Rongelapis had been returned to their home atoll. Life returned to normal until January 1954, when 28 American military personnel, 25 Air Force, and 3 Army arrived at the Rongerik Atoll, 45 miles east of Rongelap, to operate a weather station. Meanwhile, a Trust Territory field officer from Hawaii arrived in Rongelap by ship and told John Anjain that the Americans would soon again be testing atomic bombs at Bikini. Although the tests were of much more powerful nuclear devices than those detonated in 1946, the field officer told Anjain there were no orders to move the inhabitants of Rongelap. For the next 6 weeks, Anjain and the other Rongelapis went about their daily routines. Just after 3 a.m. on March 1, 1954, some 90 miles west of Bikini, the 23-man crew of the Japanese fishing boat Lucky Dragon No. 5 was setting out fishing lines for their final attempt to catch tuna before heading back to their home port of Yaizu. When the Lucky Dragon had left Japan on January 22nd for this, its 5th voyage as a tuna boat, her regular skipper, Captain Shimizu, was not aboard. He had to stay in Yaizu for a hemorrhoid operation, so the boat's owner, a businessman named Kakuichi Nishikawa, had selected as his replacement 22-year-old Hisakichi Tsutsui, a newly licensed captain, recently graduated from the Aichi Prefectural Fishery School. The man who really took command, however, was Yoshio Misaki, a 29-year-old who had the requisite experience to have the title of fishing master. Just before the ship cast off, the boat owner huddled with Misaki and directed him to fish around the Midway Islands, some 2,000 miles east, where the seas were rougher than those farther south, but the possibilities for catching large, big-eye tuna were considered better. The first sign of trouble came just hours after departure, when the crew found they had left behind a spare crank, a key part for the engine. Instead of returning to Yaizu, which would be bad luck, the fishermen went to Ogawa, a nearby port, to buy the part. After loading the extra crank and attempting to depart, the Lucky Dragon ran aground on a sandbar, leaving no choice but to wait for the high tide and a final departure 4 hours later. For its first 5 days out at sea, the Lucky Dragon was caught in winter storms and several times almost swamped by giant waves. It was not until after the boat had passed Torishima Island, about 370 miles southwest of Yaizu, that Misaki told the captain and the rest of the crew that they would be heading more or less directly east for Midway, amid rougher seas than the calmer southern waters where the Lucky Dragon had fished before. The crew was not happy, but they were somewhat cheered when Misaki pointed out that near Midway they had a good chance for landing tuna, popular with Americans. Their pay depended on the size and quality of the catch. The first fishing day was February 7th, when the Lucky Dragon was about 200 miles southwest of Midway. The tricky process of letting out the fishing lines usually began around 3 a.m., when the first 12-inch floating buoy with a light on top is pushed off the stern with a line attached that drops down vertically into the sea. Stringing out horizontally from it as the ship moves forward is the so-called long line, to which every 1,000 feet are attached five branch lines, each with a steel leader and a hook baited with frozen fish. Another surface floating buoy is attached with a light atop every 20th of them. To release the Lucky Dragon's 330 lines generally took about 4 hours, and the buoys could stretch out to almost 55 miles. When that first big chore was finished, the ship halted and the crew took breakfast. 4 hours later, the even harder job of hauling in the lines began. A power winch pulled in the main line as the boat went from buoy to buoy, and the crew brought in the branch lines and the catch. This process could take as long as 14 hours, because the lines must all be carefully coiled with the buoys detached and stored separately. That first day, the crew had caught only one or two big-eye tuna, and they were smaller than the average of nearly 300 pounds and 6 feet in length. Another eight were even smaller. Because tuna are warm-blooded fish, they must be cut up and put on ice very quickly to keep their red flesh firm. So that first day, it was close to midnight before all the work was done. It had not been a good catch, with only several hundred pounds of fish landed, as opposed to the more normal 1,000-plus pounds. The next day, the weather turned windy, and it was not until early on February 9th that the lines were again set out, and by afternoon there was engine trouble when the lines were being winched in. Suddenly, the men saw that the main line had been severed. Perhaps shifting currents had caught some of the hooks on coral reefs. After searching for 4 days and finding plenty of buoys but only some lines, they worked out that 170 lines, over half the ship's capability, had been lost. It was too soon to go back to Japan, so the troubled ship went south and then west toward the Marshall Islands, where the seas would be less rough. Fishing as they went, they had good and bad days catching various types of tuna, but fuel was running low. By the end of February, they were in the Marshalls and fished near Utterick Atoll. They now had some 9 tons of fish on ice. They turned west toward Bikini. March 1st would be their last day of fishing before heading home. When the boat had left Japan, no crew member knew that the U.S. government had alerted the Japanese Maritime Safety Agency of its planned nuclear tests, and that an exclusion zone had been established around Bikini Atoll, extending eastward and very close to where the crew was now setting their lines. The radio man, Kuboyama Aikichi, was a small, stocky man with a loud voice. At 39, he was the oldest and most learned of the crew. A seaman most of his life, with a wife and 3 children, he knew that a few years back there had been a restricted area around Bikini for the first American nuclear tests, and he had warned the captain and fishing master to stay away from Bikini. Still, at 3 a.m. on March 1st, the fishing master fixed the Lucky Dragon's location at 90 miles outside the old restricted area. Shortly thereafter, the crew began to release the lines as the boat headed slowly on its west-southwest course. Part 1. The First Tests. 1. In the Beginning. Using radioactive materials as a weapon of terror or death had been a highly secret part of the U.S. pre-World War II atomic bomb research. In short, part of the initial thinking among American scientists included developing what now is called a dirty bomb. The idea had first emerged from a May 17, 1941 National Academy of Sciences report on atomic fission by a committee chaired by Nobel Prize-winning physicist Arthur Compton. The men were studying whether the government should devote a major scientific effort toward developing an atomic bomb. At the time, it was believed that Hitler Germany was making progress in such an effort. The authors of this 8-page National Academy report wrote that with a vastly increased uranium research effort, it would seem to us unlikely that the use of nuclear fission can become of military importance within less than 2 years. They went on to list proposed military applications for radioactive materials produced by a uranium fission reaction. They included use as a power source for ships and submarines, or for violently explosive bombs. The first use suggested for the violently radioactive materials produced would be as missiles destructive to life. The paper read, "These might then be carried by airplanes to be scattered as bombs over enemy territory to cause radiological injury." The report added, "This might be the most promptly applicable military use, although it might not be available within less than 12 months of the first production of a chain reaction, so not earlier than 1943. In the summer of 1942, Compton believed Nazi Germany was going down this path, writing to James B. Conant, physicist and Harvard University president, "We have become convinced there is real danger of bombardment by the Germans within the next few months, using bombs designed to spread radioactive materials in lethal quantities." In 1943, Manhattan Project research work on the atomic bomb was proceeding at Los Alamos National Laboratory in New Mexico, under the direction of Dr. Robert Oppenheimer, who discussed various potential applications with leading scientists, including Dr. Enrico Fermi, head of the team that built the first self-sustaining nuclear chain reaction in Chicago. Oppenheimer and Fermi talked about using fission materials, particularly strontium, to poison German food supplies. This approach was dropped after Oppenheimer wrote to Fermi that he thought it unfeasible unless we can poison food sufficient to kill 500,000 men. Such studies continued. An October 30, 1943 report entitled "Use of Radioactive Materials as a Military Weapon," written by Compton, Conant, and chemist Harold Urey, another Nobel Prize winner, was sent to Lieutenant General Leslie Groves, director of the Manhattan Project. This report recommended that additional work be authorized on the use of radioactive materials in order that this country may be ready to use such materials or be ready to defend itself against the use of such materials. One offensive application proposed was the grinding of radioactive particles into microscopic size and, as dust or smoke, using it as a gas warfare instrument. It could be delivered via a ground-fired projectile or an aerial bomb. In this form, it would be inhaled by personnel, the report said. The amount necessary to cause death to a person inhaling the material is extremely small. It has been estimated that 1/1,000,000th of a gram accumulating in a person's body would be fatal. There are no known methods of treatment for such a casualty. The authors also suggested use of radioactive materials for what they called terrain contaminant. That meant using a weapon that spread radioactive materials on the ground in order to deny terrain to either side except at the expense of exposing personnel to harmful radiations. Depending on the quantities of radioactive materials used, effects on a person would probably not be immediate but be delayed for days or perhaps weeks depending upon the amounts of exposure, they wrote. In addition, they said contamination from radioactive material would be dangerous until the slow natural decay of the material took place, which would take weeks and even months. Their memo even suggested that radioactive material could be weaponized for ingestion into human bodies by targeting reservoirs or wells. 4 days' production of radioactive materials could contaminate 1,000,000 gallons of water to an extent that a quart drunk in 1 day would probably result in complete incapacitation or death in about a month's time, they wrote. The authors recommended that if military authorities feel that the United States should be ready to use radioactive weapons in case the enemy started it first, studies on the subject should be started immediately. Pursuit of such dirty bombs was eventually set aside because of the successful progress being made in developing the first atomic bombs. But based on their past planning, key atomic scientists were clearly aware of the threat posed by radioactive materials, such as fallout created by detonation of a nuclear weapon more than 70 years ago. In the spring of 1945, with preparations for the initial Trinity test of a plutonium-based atomic device well underway, the main focus of Manhattan Project scientists was getting the maximum destructive effect from an atomic explosion. Since nearly half the destructive energy released from a detonation would come in the form of blast, with another 35% coming from heat, those elements drew the most attention. Radioactive fallout was mostly an afterthought, since radiation would be only 15% of the energy the weapon's detonation would release. Focus was on the altitude at which the atomic bomb would be detonated in order for the explosion to create the greatest blast and heat effects over the widest area. A two-day meeting of what was called the Target Committee was held on May 10th and 11th, 1945, in Oppenheimer's office at Site Y, the then classified name for the Los Alamos National Laboratory in New Mexico. The first topic of discussion was listed as height of detonation, according to a once top-secret May 12, 1945 summary of the meetings, declassified in June 1974. The goal for both the uranium and plutonium atomic bombs was a detonation at a height that would cause overpressure of 5 psi, pounds per square inch, on the ground. Such a blast overpressure would create a wind speed of 163 miles per hour and collapse most buildings, causing immediate widespread fatalities and universal injuries. At the Target Committee meeting, expectations were voiced that Little Boy, the uranium bomb, would have a yield from 5 to 15 kilotons, 5,000 to 15,000 tons of TNT, and that the detonation fuse should be set to go off at an altitude somewhere between 1,550 to 2,400 feet above ground for the best destructive results. For Fat Man, the plutonium-triggered bomb, the expected yield was to be determined after the Trinity test, since that device was of the same design. It was tentatively determined that detonation altitude would be around 1,400 feet. The declassified memo listed another agenda item as psychological factors in target selection. The group agreed there was great importance in using the new bomb to get the greatest psychological effect against Japan and to make the initial use sufficiently spectacular for the importance of the weapon to be internationally recognized when publicity on it is released. To put it bluntly, Oppenheimer and his colleagues wanted to destroy as many buildings as possible and kill and injure so many people that the world would recognize something really terrifying had been added to warfare. Of course, they didn't want to be seen as going after civilians. Another item on their agenda was use against military objectives. But notice they saw fit to put military in quotation marks. They said the initial weapon was to be used on a small and strictly military objective, but that the target should be located in a much larger area subject to blast damage in order to avoid undue risks of the weapon being lost due to bad placing of the bomb. When it came to Hiroshima, the first target, that city was described as an important army depot and port of embarkation in the middle of an urban industrial area. It is a good radar target, and it is such a size that a large part of the city could be extensively damaged, emphasis added. Nagasaki wasn't even on the original target list. It was added after Secretary of War Henry Stimson objected to going after Kyoto, Japan's ancient cultural capital. Even then, Nagasaki was the alternate target, The one hit because there was cloud cover over Kokura, the original selection. The Target Committee's radiological effect discussion of the bomb was devoted to recommendations associated with safety of the mission's American aircraft and crews, rather than the radiation exposure of the Japanese people on the ground. The memo called for no other U.S. aircraft flying closer than 2.5 miles from the detonation site or near the radioactive cloud the bomb created. On May 31, 1945, another key meeting was held in Secretary of War Henry Stimson's office next door to the White House. The first test of an atomic device was looming in 6 weeks, and the first use of an atomic bomb was expected shortly thereafter. It was a meeting of what was called the Interim Committee, appointed by President Truman less than a month after he became president, to discuss recommendations on temporary wartime controls, public announcement, legislation, and post-war organization, according to notes from the session. In attendance were General George C. Marshall, at that time Army Chief of Staff, James F. Burns, then Special Assistant to President Truman, William L. Clayton, a successful businessman and Assistant Secretary of State, Ralph A. Bard, a financier and Undersecretary of the Navy, Dr. Vannevar Bush, an engineer, founder of Raytheon Corps, and one-time president of MIT, but then effectively Truman's science advisor as director of the Office of Scientific Research and Development, Carl T. Compton, a physicist who helped develop radar and another former MIT president, and Harvard's Conant, who was then also chairman of the National Defense Research Committee. Also present were Oppenheimer, along with Fermi, Arthur Compton, and Dr. E. O. Lawrence, each of whom had run elements of the Manhattan Project. Finally, there was Major General Groves, manager of the project. Chairing the session was Stimson, a Republican former Secretary of State from the Hoover administration, whom President Roosevelt had brought into his cabinet in 1940 to show bipartisanship as it became apparent the U.S. would become involved in World War II. Did that group, almost 70 years ago, get everything right? People have argued that those first bombs should not have been dropped. General Marshall, in fact, at one point during a meeting, made that very argument, although he would change his mind. But listen to what they did say and then do. At that May 31st session, with Marshall's support, Stimson said the Manhattan Project should not be considered simply in terms of military weapons, but as a new relationship of man to the universe. He called what was about to happen more important than the discovery of gravity because of its effect on the lives of men. For that reason, he said, it was important to realize that the implications of the project went far beyond the needs of the present war. The atomic bomb, Stimson said, looking toward the future, must be controlled, if possible, to make it an assurance of future peace rather than a menace to civilization. He then laid out the topics for discussion. Future military weapons, future international competition, future research, future controls, and future developments, particularly non-military. On future weapons, the speaker was Compton. At this meeting, he, Conant, and Oppenheimer foresaw the second and third generation of what was to become the thermonuclear bomb, the so-called H-bomb. Oppenheimer predicted it might produce an explosive force equal to 10 million to 100 million tons of TNT. When it came to future domestic programs, Lawrence pressed for the U.S. to stay ahead in this field and insisted that research had to go on unceasingly. Oppenheimer pointed out that one of the difficult problems involved in guiding a future domestic program would be the allocation of materials as between different uses. He said what was being done to build the bomb under war pressure was simply a process of plucking the fruits of earlier research, and to exploit more fully the potentialities of this field, it was felt that some more leisurely and a more normal research situation should be established. Bush joined Oppenheimer to emphasize that while concentration had to be on weapons during this wartime setting, in peacetime such focus would be completely wrong. they both agreed that only a nucleus of the present Manhattan Project staff should be retained, and that as many as possible should be released for broader and freer inquiry back in their universities and research laboratories, according to the meeting notes. The initial nuclear research had been directed at a weapon to shorten the war, but this development had only opened the way to future discoveries, according to Oppenheimer, who then attempted to illustrate both his practicality and his idealism. First, fundamental knowledge of nuclear fission was widespread throughout the world, and so it might be wise for the United States to offer to the world free interchange of information with particular emphasis on the development of peacetime uses. The basic goal of all endeavors in the field should be the enlargement of human welfare, Oppenheimer continued, adding a suggestion that never took hold. If we were to offer to exchange information before the bomb was actually used, our moral position would be greatly strengthened. Stimson referred to an earlier Vannevar Bush Conant memorandum that had recommended a future international organization to handle the exchange of nuclear information and promote cooperation. There should be complete scientific freedom, but the right of inspection should be given to an international control body, he said. Still, he recognized the writing on the wall, asking aloud what kind of inspection would be effective when faced with the difference between democratic governments as against totalitarian regimes under such a program of international control coupled with scientific freedom. Although a World War II ally in the fight against Germany and potentially needed to assist a coordinated effort against Japan, the Soviet Union, then under the iron fist of Joseph Stalin, drew special attention. Bush was first to express doubt that the U.S. could remain ahead permanently if we were to turn over completely to the Russians the results of our research under free competition with no reciprocal exchange. Oppenheimer joined in expressing doubts concerning the possibility of knowing what was going on in this field in Russia. Marshall cautioned against putting too much faith in the effectiveness of the inspection proposal. He was concerned about the Soviet military's penchant for secrecy, and thus questioned whether they would be willing partners. Instead, Marshall said he favored building up of a combination among like-minded powers, thereby forcing Russia to fall in line by the very force of this coalition. Burns was fearful that if information were given to the Russians, even in general terms, Stalin would ask to be brought into the partnership. Thus, they would learn program details at a time, he said, when the U.S. program had to push ahead as fast as possible to make certain that we stay ahead and at the same time make every effort to better our political relations with Russia. When the discussion turned to Japan, Oppenheimer vividly described how the first atomic bomb would be different from previous conventional heavy bombing of Japanese cities. The visual effect would be tremendous, accompanied by a brilliant luminescence which would rise to a height of 10,000 to 20,000 feet, while the neutron effect of the explosion would be dangerous to life for a radius of at least two-thirds of a mile. There was general agreement, Stimson said, that we could not give the Japanese any warning, that we could not concentrate on a civilian area, but that we should seek to make a profound psychological impression on as many of the inhabitants as possible. Following a suggestion of Conant, which reflected the targeting committee's view, Stimson agreed that the most desirable target would be a vital war plant employing a large number of workers and closely surrounded by workers' houses. In short, the first twistedly logical use of nuclear weapons, and so far their only real proposed use, were as terror weapons, not to fight a war, but to end a war by killing and injuring as many people as possible, while pretending the target was only military in nature. 2. The First Fallout. In April 1945, just 3 months ahead of the proposed Trinity shot, the world's first nuclear explosion, Hans Bethe, who ran the Manhattan Project Theoretical Division, had assigned two of his physicists, Joseph Hirschfelder and John McGee, to look at what would be the after effects. The Trinity device was to be detonated from a platform at the top of a 100-foot-tall steel tower. The expected explosion, Hirschfelder later wrote, would pick up dirt, rocks, and assorted debris, some of which would pass through the fireball and get plated with radioactive materials. Hirschfelder and McGee's early predictions, after studying the expected fireball, heat, wind currents, the season, and time of day of the shot, were that enormous amounts of radioactive dust could fall down on surrounding towns, while some of it could drift much farther away. Their initial estimates, according to Trinity historian Ferenc Szasz, represented a danger so lethal as to make the test virtually impossible. After studying the effects of a 100-ton dry-run explosion of TNT that had been mixed with a minuscule amount of fission products, they lowered their estimates, but realized that much depended upon the wind. In spite of all this work, very few people believed us when we predicted radiation fallout, according to Hirschfelder. The two scientists, supported by Manhattan Project's health group, convinced Groves and Oppenheimer to set up a monitoring system for possible radioactive fallout from the Trinity shot, and a map was made of every resident within a 40-mile radius of Ground Zero. A military detachment of 160 men were made ready to evacuate up to 450 people should fallout occur. Another 25 members of the Army Counterintelligence Corps, CIC, were sent to towns and cities up to 100 miles from the test site. They were to request evacuation troops if needed, or help manage public relations. The CIC members were armed with a cover story that a large ammunition dump with some gas shells had exploded on the test site, which required a clearing of the surrounding area. 44 monitors were stationed to the northeast, which was the direction the wind was expected to blow. The plan was to call them by telephone after the shot and tell them how high, how fast, and which way the radioactive cloud was heading as it crossed New Mexico and drifted into Colorado. 2 hours before the planned 4 a.m. Trinity detonation, there were thunderstorms around the site, but the rain eventually stopped, leaving a still overcast sky. Detonation was put off for an hour. When the overcast began to break, about 4:45 a.m., the shot was set for 5:30 a.m. The Trinity device proved more efficient than expected, and the explosion sent the fireball as a reddish-brown stem up 10,000 feet, while above it the mushroom cloud blossomed out at 25,000 feet. Light winds of about 10 miles per hour pushed the entire structure in a northeasterly direction. It rose so high that it was 10 miles from ground zero before the wind-carried fallout of fission products began dropping from the dissipating cloud. Hirschfelder and McGee, dressed in white coveralls with dangling gas masks and driving an old sedan, followed the cloud north of the Nevada test site, accompanied by some soldiers. At a crossroads store 15 miles northeast of Ground Zero, an old man recognized they were from the test site and said, "You boys must have been up to something this morning. The sun came up in the west and went on down again." The two drove on to a site 19.5 miles northeast of Ground Zero, where Army Searchlight Station L-8's unit had parked, there to light up the cloud in the pre-dawn darkness. The soldiers had breakfast steaks cooking on a grill when Hirschfelder and McGee arrived, about 90 minutes after detonation, at the same time that a light dusting of radioactive particles was drifting down. McGee's readings of low radiation levels around 8:30 a.m. convinced the troops to bury the meat and leave the area. Overall, however, the monitors who gathered at the end of the day decided that Trinity's fallout had not caused any serious danger. That was not the end. It turned out that a hot spot had developed in an area 20 miles northeast of the test site, where the road ran through a narrow gorge. The next day, monitors discovered a house and a ranch off that road that had been missed by the Army. An elderly couple, the Ratliffs, lived there with some dogs and livestock. They had been indoors most of the previous day, so they missed most of the fallout, although Mr. Ratliff told a visiting scientist that the ground immediately after the shot appeared covered with light snow, and for several days the ground and fence posts had the appearance of being frosted. Some of Rateliff's animals showed signs of beta burns, and within weeks lost hair and had discolored coats. By fall, ranchers in the area sold some 75 head of cattle they said had shown burns or discoloration after the Trinity test. Aircraft equipped with filters had followed the Trinity cloud across Kansas, Iowa, Indiana, and up through upstate New York and New England when it finally went out to sea. Months after the test, the Eastman Kodak Company in Rochester, New York, received complaints of fogging of its X-ray film by tiny exposed spots, making that film unusable. A company scientist, Dr. John H. Webb, began an investigation and discovered a year later that beta particle radioactive fallout from the Trinity explosion had contaminated Wabash River water used by the mill in Ohio that made the cardboard packaging that was supposed to protect the X-ray film. Webb and the company kept his discovery secret, except for a call made a year later to the Atomic Energy Commission, AEC, which had just been established to manage the development, use, and control of atomic energy. The AEC's Merrill Eisenbud, then director of its health and safety laboratory, years later remembered hearing a fallout some 1,000 miles away from the explosion. "I was amazed because I got the call from Rochester saying that they had had fallout," he told an interviewer. "And so when I called around, I found out that nobody had a monitoring program, which amazed me. So, you know, we got into it in that way." The Army, from the beginning, was not eager to deal with fallout from atomic testing at the Nevada site. The possibility of endless lawsuits haunted the military, plus the necessity of keeping the whole test program secret. At the end of July, the War Department authorized Los Alamos medical personnel to discreetly investigate the health of persons exposed to Trinity fallout under suitable pretext, according to a 1986 Los Alamos History Project report. After the atomic bombs were dropped on Hiroshima and Nagasaki in early August 1945, the Trinity shot was publicly revealed, but the reasons for the follow-up medical visits to individuals who were exposed to Trinity's fallout were not disclosed to the residents, the history records. Dr. Lewis Hempelman, a doctor in the Los Alamos Health Group, wrote after Trinity, "A few people were probably overexposed, but they couldn't prove it, and we couldn't prove it, so we just assumed we got away with it." Historical records indicate that pressures to maintain secrecy and avoid legal claims led to decisions that would not likely have been made in later tests, according to the history. Dr. Stafford Warren, then chief of the Manhattan Project Medical Section, in his report on the Trinity test, said no area investigated received a dangerous amount of radiation. He did say the radioactive cloud was potentially a very serious hazard over a band almost 30 miles wide, extending almost 90 miles northeast of the site. One obvious lesson from Trinity was that detonating a nuclear device close to the ground increases fallout, and that doing it at high altitudes, where most of the fireball does not hit ground levels, results in less dispersal of radioactive fallout. 2 days after Trinity, Warren recommended the test site be expanded or a new one found. General Groves agreed. He decided the Trinity test site was too small and a larger site was needed, preferably with a radius of at least 150 miles without population. 16 hours after the United States' August 6, 1945 atomic bombing of Hiroshima, President Truman announced that the nation had produced an explosive power more than 2,000 times the blast power of the British Grand Slam, which was the largest bomb ever yet used in the history of warfare. Grand Slam was a 22,000-pound, 10-ton earthquake bomb used 49 times by the Royal Air Force in 1945 against German targets during the Second World War. Truman added a threat. "In their present form, these bombs are in production, and even more powerful forms are in development." As a result, the president added, "We are now prepared to obliterate more rapidly and completely every productive enterprise the Japanese have above ground in any city. We shall destroy their docks, their factories, and their communications. Let there be no mistake. We shall completely destroy Japan's power to make war." No details were given, such as the size of the bomb or the plane that had delivered it. 3 days later, a second atomic bomb was dropped on Nagasaki. This time, General Carl A. Spotts, commander of the U.S. Strategic Air Forces in the Pacific, made the announcement from Guam. It was not the main story on the front page of the August 9, 1945 New York Times. That pride of place went to the Soviet Union's declaration of war against Japan. When news of the Nagasaki bombing reached Tokyo, Japanese Foreign Minister Shigenori Togo proposed acceptance of the Potsdam Declaration, which called for the unconditional surrender of all Japanese armed forces. Japan's Supreme Council for the Direction of the War, meeting in an underground bomb shelter, deadlocked on a decision after debating the matter through the night of August 9th. At 2 a.m. August 10th, Prime Minister Admiral Baron Kentaro Suzuki pleaded with 41-year-old Emperor Hirohito to decide. Hirohito said, "I do not desire any further destruction of cultures, nor any additional misfortune for the peoples of the world. On this occasion, we have to bear the unbearable." Surrender announcement was set for August 15th. Some Japanese army officers continued to oppose the emperor's decision and even planned a mini coup. It failed. On August 15th, Hirohito went on the radio to announce the end of the war, allowing his own people for the first time to hear his actual voice. It was not until the late 1970s, as a Washington Post reporter covering national security affairs, that I gradually learned more details about those initial atomic weapons. Little Boy, the uranium-based weapon, was 10 feet long, 28 inches in diameter, and weighed 9,700 pounds. The first atomic bomb used in war, it was dropped on August 6, 1945, at 8:15 a.m. from the B-29 named Enola Gay, piloted by Colonel Paul W. Tibbetts, Jr. Little Boy was guided by a parachute and detonated at 2,000 feet over Hiroshima to maximize its yield of 12.5 kilotons, the equivalent of 12,500 tons of TNT. Only later did we hear that it immediately killed some 80,000 of the roughly 350,000 people who lived in Hiroshima, with thousands more having died later from radiation. 5 square miles of the city was destroyed. The United States Strategic Bombing Survey later reported, "The damage and casualties caused at Hiroshima by the one atomic bomb dropped from a single plane would have required 220 B-29s carrying 1,200 tons of incendiary bombs, 400 tons of high-explosive bombs, and 500 tons of anti-personnel fragmentation bombs, if conventional weapons rather than an atomic bomb had been used." 3 days later, on August 9th, the B-29 named Box Car, piloted by Colonel Charles W. Sweeney, dropped Fat Man, the plutonium-based weapon, at 11:02 a.m. over Nagasaki. It was 10 feet 8 inches long and 60 inches in diameter and weighed 10,800 pounds. To have maximum immediate impact, the Nagasaki bomb, detonated at an altitude of 1,800 feet, had an explosive power of 22 kilotons, 22,000 tons of TNT. It killed an estimated 40,000 of the city's 200,000 population. The hilly nature of the city had limited the major destruction to roughly 4 square miles. Truman's dramatic picture of what one atomic bomb could do has faded from people's minds. Those two atomic bombs were drops in the ocean compared to the power resting in the thousands of thermonuclear bombs and warheads that the U.S., Russia, and other countries now possess. Nuclear weapons today are thought more of in terms of numbers deployed or stored by a nation, and for use as foreign policy tools. Or, just as likely, domestic political weapons at home to make those in power appear strong. 3. We did not rest. Immediately after World War II, the United States felt secure with its monopoly of atomic weapons. Two such bombs had brought the war with Japan to a quick end, but as Oppenheimer and his colleagues had predicted, research and inevitably further testing would go on, seeking second and third generation atomic weapons leading up to the 1954 Bravo thermonuclear bomb test. The post-war testing between 1945 and 1954 developed little knowledge about radioactive fallout and its long-term effects on people and the environment. Even before Japan surrendered, American military leaders, particularly in the Navy, were concerned about the future role of its warships in an atomic age and began to press for further testing of nuclear weapons. One day after Japan's Emperor Hirohito gave a recorded radio address announcing his country's surrender, Louis Strauss, a Navy officer assisting then-Secretary of the Navy James V. Forrestal, sent a memo to his boss on August 16, 1945, arguing, "If such a test is not made, there will be loose talk to the effect that the fleet is obsolete in the face of this new weapon, and this will militate against appropriations to preserve a post-war Navy of the size now planned." 9 days later, Senator Brian McMahon, Democrat, Connecticut, chairman of the Senate's new Special Committee on Atomic Energy, publicly called for use of an atomic bomb to see its impact on Navy warships. "I would like to see these Japanese naval ships taken to sea and an atomic bomb dropped on them. The resulting explosion should prove to us just how effective the atomic bomb is when used against the giant naval ships. I can think of no better use for these Jap ships." The proposal was picked up by the top officers of the Army Air Forces, and on September 18, 1945, its commander, H.H. Hap Arnold, presented a proposal that a number of Japanese ships be made available for tests involving atomic bombs and other weapons. The Navy responded a month later, with Chief of Naval Operations Admiral Ernest J. King suggesting the Joint Chiefs controlled the tests, with Army and Navy participation. Inter-service rivalry has a long history, and that one bomb be dropped by air and another exploded in the water. He also proposed that some older and surplus U.S. warships be included within the targeted area. Joint planning began within a month, with an ad hoc subcommittee set up to make a detailed proposal. Then Major General Curtis E. LeMay, who later became the tough, legendary head of Strategic Air Command, took over as chairman of that steering committee. Scientists from the Manhattan Project and military officers at earlier meetings had agreed that the tests should gather data on the nature, range, and duration of radiation danger, bomb efficiency, burst location, wave formation, and ship movement, according to a 1984 Defense Nuclear Agency history of what became the Bikini tests. In addition, they sought information to aid in assessing damage from and designing protection against nuclear weapons, and facts that would be helpful in learning to detect nuclear detonations. One member of LeMay's panel was then Commodore William S. Deke Parsons, who months later would become an admiral. Parsons was an unusual Navy officer. Though essentially a military man, he had a scientist's mindset. After the Naval Academy, he found himself focused on ordnance. At the beginning of World War II, he had dealt with radar, proximity fuses, and in 1943 had been assigned to Project Y, the code name for the Manhattan Project at Los Alamos, New Mexico. For the next 2 years, he had worked with scientists on ordnance problems associated with building the atomic bombs. He had flown on the Enola Gay, and while in flight on the way to Japan, had personally armed the Hiroshima bomb. It took 6 weeks of subcommittee meetings to thrash out controversies such as who should command the prospective joint task force and whether target vessels would carry full loads of ammunition, something the Navy opposed since it could heighten the effects of the bomb if fires from the oil or gasoline from one ship ignited other closely anchored ships. On January 10, 1946, President Truman approved a preliminary plan with Vice Admiral William H.P. Blandy, a Deputy Chief of Naval Operations for Special Weapons, chosen by the Joint Chiefs to run the operation as head of Joint Task Force 1. Admiral Parsons, with his Manhattan Project connections, was made Deputy Task Force Commander. Because scientists often came crying to him for help, he drew the codename Wet Nurse. It was Blandy who gave the plan the name Operation Crossroads, chosen, he said, because it was apparent that warfare, perhaps civilization itself, had been brought to a turning point in history by this revolutionary weapon. The initial plan was to conduct 3 tests to determine, under controlled conditions, atomic bomb effects such as pressure, heat, shockwave velocity, as well as visual and nuclear radiation. One test, called Able, would duplicate the drop on Nagasaki, which was an airburst, but this time over water. The second, Baker, would imitate an atomic bomb attack on a fleet at anchor, such as Pearl Harbor, but by exploding a preset device at a shallow depth beneath the anchored ships. The third test, Charlie, would also study underwater effects, this time down to 2,000 feet, with only a small number of vessels above it. One of the first problems was finding a site for the tests. An Army and Navy group agreed that a protected body of water at least 6 miles in diameter was needed to provide anchorage not only for the target fleet, but also for the support ships aiding in the tests. The test site had to be uninhabited or have such a small population that people easily could be evacuated. The site had to be at least 300 miles from the nearest population center because of possible radioactive fallout, which was still an unmeasured and thus a speculated effect of atomic weaponry. The weather had to be right, guaranteeing no severe cold or violent storms. Another requirement had to be predictable, directionally uniform winds at all altitudes up to 60,000 feet, so there was no chance of fallout coming back over the task force personnel. Finally, the area had to be under U.S. control, with an American B-29 airbase within 1,000 miles, since the first test bomb would be dropped from such a plane. After studying areas in the Atlantic and the Pacific, the Navy decided on the Marshall Islands, and, in particular, Bikini Atoll. It was a string of 23 coral islands, totaling 3.4 square miles, that surrounded a deep 230-square-mile blue-green lagoon. Bikini was hundreds of miles from the main east-west shipping lanes of the Pacific. Its weather was temperate, and its winds were considerably more stable than those of other ocean areas. More important, the Marshall Islands were a trust territory under U.S. control. In January 1946, the American delegate to the United Nations Trusteeship Council asked for permission to use part of the Marshall Islands trust area for military purposes and to keep any test sites closed to other nations. It would not be until April 2, 1947, that the UN Security Council would finally approve the terms of trusteeship, and July 18, 1947, when it entered into force. In late January 1946, the U.S. Congress held a series of hearings on a House joint resolution that authorized the use of Navy ships to determine the effect of atomic weapons upon such vessels. At a Senate Committee on Atomic Energy hearing on January 24, 1946, Blandy said, "The ultimate results of the tests, so far as the Navy is concerned, will be their translation into terms of United States sea power. Secondary purposes are to afford training for Army Air Forces personnel in attack with the atomic bomb against ships, and to determine the effect of the atomic bomb upon military installations and equipment." There was opposition to the proposed tests, much of it based on false fears that the Earth would crack open or that all life would end. Concern became such that Blandy gave public speeches to try to calm down nervous citizens. During a February 21, 1946 evening speech before a local Philadelphia Red Cross chapter, he said, "The bomb will not kill half the fish in the sea and poison the other half so they will kill all the people who eat fish hereafter. The bomb will not cause an earthquake or push up new mountain ranges. The bomb will not start a chain reaction in the water, converting it all to gas and letting all the ships on all the oceans drop down to the bottom. It will not blow out the bottom of the sea and let all the water run down the hole. It will not destroy gravity. I am not an atomic playboy, as one of my critics labeled me, exploding these bombs to satisfy my personal whim. House Joint Resolution 307 passed on March 12, 1946, by a 313-25 vote, but because of concerns about nuclear testing, 94 members, including both Republicans and Democrats, voted present. Among them were Representative Christian Herter, Republican, Massachusetts, who would later be Secretary of State, and then Representative Claire Booth Luce, Republican, Connecticut, a successful playwright, leading conservative politician, and wife of Henry Luce, powerful co-founder and publisher of Time and Life magazines. The use of Bikini Atoll required the relocation of its 167 Marshallese inhabitants. With May 15, 1946 as the date for the first test, Blandy wanted the Bikinians off their atoll by March 15. On Sunday, February 10, 1946, the then military governor of the Marshalls, U.S. Navy Commodore Ben H. Wyatt, flew by seaplane to Bikini. He assembled the Bikinians, with King Judah, their chief magistrate of the atoll, present. Navy records have reported that Wyatt told the Bikinians of the bomb that men in America had made, and of the destruction it had wrought upon the enemy, Japan. "Americans," Wyatt said, "are trying to learn how to use it for the good of mankind and to end all world wars." He then asked, "Would Judah and his people be willing to sacrifice their islands for the welfare of all men and for the good of mankind and to end all world wars?" He asked whether they would temporarily leave their atoll so the United States could begin testing atomic bombs. The Bikinians were told that they would be allowed to return to their atoll in a matter of months, when the United States no longer needed it for Operation Crossroads. That same month, the Joint Task Force had selected Rongelap Atoll, 125 miles to the east, as the future temporary home of the Bikinians. It was a previously uninhabited island, but only one-sixth the size of Bikini. No one seemed to care that it had scant resources for long-term survival, since the belief was that the move would only be temporary. Having suffered under Japanese military occupation during World War II, and wishing to please their new American guardians, Judah led a meeting of the Bikini Atoll Council to make the decision. He emerged from the subsequent deliberations to announce, "We will go, believing that everything is in the hands of God." Navy Seabees arrived February 26, 1946 on Rongerik and began constructing cisterns to catch water and 26 housing frames for 40 families, many of whom would initially live together. These were covered either with pine wood or with pandanus thatch. Just before the Bikinians were moved from their atoll in early March, U.S. Navy cameramen restaged Wyatt's consultation with King Judah, who for the scene was wearing a military uniform. The film was prepared for public relations use in the U.S., and according to the George Washington University's National Security Archives, the performance concluded with the Bikinians having their last church service on the atoll and then meeting at the graveyard before departing. On March 7, 1946, with the cisterns initially filled with 25,000 gallons of water from Kwajalein, the 167 Bikinians were loaded on Navy LST-1108, a cavernous landing ship with a crew of more than 200 that normally was used to carry M4 Sherman battle tanks to an invasion spot. The Bikinians brought with them some outrigger canoes and materials from their church, community building, and individual homes. On the next day, March 8, 1946, they disembarked at Rongerik. It wasn't long before the Bikinians found that there were very few coconuts on trees in Rongerik. In fact, there were very few fruit trees at all, and the lagoon lacked a big enough supply of edible fish. It was only months after leaving their home atoll that they asked to be moved back to Bikini. However, the Navy and the entire U.S. government temporarily forgot them. America's attention was totally focused instead on the atomic tests that would take place over and in the lagoon that had been their home. To some degree, comedian Bob Hope summed up the unconcerned American attitude toward Bikini when he joked in 1947, after the completion of Operation Crossroads, "As soon as the war ended, we located the one spot on Earth that hadn't been touched by war and blew it to hell." It has not been a joke for the Bikinians. More than 75 years later, and they have yet to return to their atoll.
4. Service rivalry at Crossroads. The first test of Operation Crossroads was to take place on May 15, 1946. However, that starting date appeared to conflict with Secretary of State James Burns's upcoming promotion of the U.S. plan to have international control of nuclear weapons. Financier and government consultant Bernard M. Baruch was scheduled to present the plan in mid-June at the United Nations. Burns, in a March cabinet meeting, had said it would be helpful from a diplomatic point of view, particularly in dealing with the Soviet Union, for the Bikini tests to be delayed. As a result, President Truman postponed the first test from May 15th to July 1st. The public explanation was that because so many members of Congress would want to attend the Bikini test, much-needed legislation would have to be delayed for more than a month while they were gone. It was better to put off the atomic bomb tests to the summer when Congress was in recess. On the surface, top Navy and Army officers hoped the tests could provide some answers to basic strategic and tactical questions raised by the new atomic age. But underlying the tests, and influencing many decisions, was a competition between the services, a problem that has continued through today despite efforts to cloak it over. At the time, syndicated columnists Joseph Alsop and Stuart Alsop referred to the tests as another grim struggle between the Navy and the Air Force. This new atomic bomb had ended the war, and it was in the hands of the Army Air Corps, which within a year would become the U.S. Air Force. Rivalry between the services was unabated, and particularly so because the War and Navy departments were also participating in an ongoing Washington debate over what, in 1947, would become a major reorganization of the government's national security framework. At the same time, the Navy was defending its then principal role in America's war plans. No matter what the threat would be in the future, senior U.S. Navy officers believed they needed to prove their warships would survive in the next war, atomic bombs or not. In the Crossroads tests, they hoped to get some support. Under attack from atomic bombs, what would be a warship's weakest links? What parts would fail, and how best to build new Navy warships so they could stand up to such an attack? What would such an attack do to the inner compartments of a ship, its boilers, turbines, guns, and fuel supplies? And, of course, what about the ship's crew that work both above and below decks? Navy medical personnel were concerned about radiation and whether a ship's steel shell would provide protection. Supporting Crossroads were some 42,000 personnel, of whom 37,000 were U.S. Navy officers and enlisted men. Most lived and worked aboard some 150 support ships, and also on various Bikini Atoll islands, where they had constructed other facilities, including bunkers, floating dry docks, and steel towers to hold cameras and recording instruments. The overall targets for the test would be a 90-ship fleet anchored in the lagoon. The vessels consisted of older U.S. Navy cruisers, destroyers, submarines, as well as a number of surplus auxiliary and amphibious crafts. Military equipment was placed aboard some ships and on Bikini's islands to measure the result of blast, heat, and radiation. There were also three captured ships, including the Prinz Eugen, a German cruiser that had been transferred to the U.S. as a war prize, the captured Japanese light cruiser, Sakawa, as well as the Japanese battleship Nagato. The latter had been the former flagship for Admiral Isoroku Yamamoto, commander-in-chief for the combined Japanese fleet, and where Yamamoto not only plotted the December 7, 1941 attack on Pearl Harbor, but also where he received the first radio report that the strikes had taken place. The Army Air Force, with its planes based in Kwajalein, conducted pre-test practice bombing runs on the aiming target ship, the USS Nevada. The aircraft crews found it difficult from high altitudes to distinguish the battleship from neighboring ships in the Bikini Lagoon, so the task force commanders decided to paint the top deck of the Nevada red-orange and install a radio-controlled searchlight for guiding the B-29 on its final bombing run. Six B-17 World War II bombers and four Navy F-6F Hellcat fighters were developed to fly with radio guidance, but without crews at crossroads. For the first time in history, these large bombers and smaller operational aircraft were modified to be able to take off, fly, and land without a human aboard. We talk a great deal about drones today, but more than 75 years ago, the drones used at Operation Crossroads were crewless. The purpose of these unmanned drones was to fly through the radioactive mushroom cloud after each test shot, taking photos and gathering air samples for radiation levels. The Army Air Corps planes, four B-29s, had their takeoffs and landings controlled by radio transmitters, some mounted on jeeps near the runway. The four Navy aircraft, F-6F Hellcat drones, were controlled remotely with radio signals from the flight deck of an aircraft carrier. Once in the air, all drones were controlled from so-called motherships flying near them. Chief of the Radiological Safety Section of the Crossroads Joint Task Force was Dr. Stafford Warren, then a colonel in the Army Medical Corps. Trained in radiation biology, Warren had been a medical officer during World War II, assigned to develop safety around the laboratories and production facilities associated with the Manhattan Project. Eventually, he became its chief medical officer and was present at the Trinity test of the first plutonium device in Alamogordo, New Mexico. He later led the team in Japan that assessed medical effects on the ground at Hiroshima and Nagasaki. Warren's group brought 20,000 devices to Crossroads to measure nuclear radiation. The most common were film badges, a small piece of unexposed photographic film wrapped to exclude light was the heart of the badge. When gamma radiation struck the badge, it penetrated the wrapping and produced a change in the film's emulsion. When red, after being placed in photographic developing solution, the darkness of the emulsion indicated the amount of radiation to which the badge had been exposed. For the Crossroads tests, thousands of film badges were placed on the target ships, below decks and compartments, and even where test animals had been situated. The second most common devices were Geiger counters, which immediately measured gamma radiation, either by motion of a needle on a dial or by producing the famous buzzing, aloud or in headphones. A single photon of gamma radiation would upset the electrostatic regime of the Geiger counter's inner workings and set off a discharge of current that moved the dial and or caused the sound. The target ships were loaded as closely as possible to battle status to include ammunition, fuel oil, gasoline, and water, while fueled aircraft were placed on decks with other Army equipment. After Hiroshima and Nagasaki, there were many technical and scientific questions that still needed answers, not the least of which were the effects of the bombs on humans, the kinds of injuries they would suffer, whether from flash burns, radiation, or secondary factors such as explosions or fires. Many of the Japanese atomic bomb survivors did not emerge as victims for months or even years after the attacks. Therefore, it was apparent to some Joint Task Force members that Operation Crossroads offered controlled conditions that had not been available in Japan. They could permit scientific data to be gathered at the time of the Crossroads explosions and immediately thereafter, which would permit development of accurate information about the biological effects on humans of atomic bombs. A government report on Crossroads outlined four specific purposes for the biological studies. It would show symptoms produced by the explosion, provide experience in cataloging injuries and detect onset of slow-developing injuries, provide experience in treating those injuries, and reveal any new kinds of after effects. A Naval Medical Research Section was created within the Joint Task Force, with members drawn initially from the Naval Medical Research Institute at Bethesda, Maryland. There were other individuals involved from the Army and civilian agencies, including the National Cancer Institute, U.S. Public Health Service, as well as university and scientific groups. The plan was to expose living animals and other biologic materials like bacteria, insects, hormones, vitamins, and even seeds to the bomb effects by putting them aboard 22 of the target ships at varying distances from the site of the burst. The plan for human medical research was to try to gain insights into injuries produced by the bomb's explosion and the resultant radiation on different living organisms. A variety of measuring devices were placed where animals were to be exposed, so factors producing injuries could be determined. These included cameras, Geiger counters, gamma ray detectors, ultraviolet recorders, thermal measuring instruments, and air pressure gauges. The USS Burleson, an attack transport, was converted with animal pens and food bins. Laboratories for pathology, hematology, radiobiology, and biochemistry testing, autopsy rooms, and accommodations for 17 medical officers. 200 pigs, 60 guinea pigs, 204 goats, 5,000 rats, and 200 mice were loaded on the Navy's USS Burleson in San Francisco in May 1946 for the trip to Bikini. More than 80 tons of hay and grains were put aboard, along with specially prepared food for the test animals. Pigs were chosen because their skin and short hair were comparable to those of humans. Uniforms were placed on some pigs to test protection of certain fabrics. Some other animals were coated with anti-flash lotions and creams to test their biomedical reaction to thermal radiation. The hair on some animals was cut to human lengths to measure effects. Goats were selected because they have body weight comparable to humans and body fluids useful for post-exposure laboratory analysis. Scientists from Cornell University, who were familiar with goat psychology, recommended that goats be added to the test to see if the explosion would change their...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.